Tan. Tan Siu Beng, I was formerly from Telecom Malaysia. We worked in the industry for the last 14 years. Right? I'm 63 now. Not retiring, I don't want to retire. Retire means sorry for you. You got all sorts of problems. Okay? So, I can say in all my years in Telecom Malaysia, I spent most of the time with fiber. I was the first to handle fiber. Do you know when was the first fiber in Malaysia? Fiber optic link in Malaysia. 1982. The trial links was done in Penang, KL, Johor, Melaka, Johor Bahru. Johor Bahru was with Johor Bahru and Taman Sentosa. We call Pelangi Exchange. Melaka was between Melaka, Tampin to Tampin Hill, Kuala Pula to Kuala Pula Hill. KL, there are three links. PJ to, what call this? The hill near PJ, what call it hill?
Gassing
Hill. Gassing. Right? Penang was from Bukit Matajang to Bukit Matajang to Riyadh Hill. All this, the first thing was using multimode. We see what multimode fiber is. Problem with multimode is there are a lot of limitations. The time the link's high capacity of 140 megabit per second. Now we are talking about 40 gig. It was only 140 megabit per second PDH, right? Pressure chronous digital hierarchy link. Meant for telephoning use. No data, no internet. In the 1980s, there was no internet in Malaysia. Internet first introduced 1995. 92. 92, and at that time, nobody think internet would grow like what we have now. Nobody, people were thinking because a computer will cost 10,000 on the table. You buy a new computer, it's about 10,000. You buy a laptop, 20,000. Who can buy? Right? That's a problem. And Telecom was offered to do internet, Telecom refused. That's why Jaring was set up. Telecom refused. But when Jaring set up, we were using Telecom facility because instead of building the network all over. Right? And I was at that time involved in setting up the network for Jaring. It's a small world because after I left Telecom, I worked with one of the CEO of Jaring, Dr. Muhammad Awanglah. If you in front of your whole office, there is a small trench in front, right? We call it micro trench. That trench belongs to Dr. Muhammad.
That's the whole you lah.
Yeah. I was wrong, it's sorry for him. It was only about 2 centimeter wide, about 300 millimeter deep. With very micro duct inside and use a blow fiber, blow cable, 216 core cable. Incidentally, just want to let you see what is the cable size. Okay. This is a 48 core cable, normal cable, used in Telecom now, right? And you look at this, this is 216 core cable. Right? This is low cable. We use air compressor to blow the cable into a duct. The one blow, we blow at one blow 2 kilometers. 2 kilometers. As the manhole, of course, is a patch through. All patch through is just 2 kilometers. It finished within about 40, 50 minutes. Done. I screwed inside that time because the machine didn't set up.
Say, blow
means the tube
is empty.
Yes, tube is empty. Air compressor, 10 bar.
To push the cable
yes.
through the
yes. Yeah. The 10 bar, I don't know how heavy is the pressure. Your tire pressure is about 4 bar only. So imagine four and three, you're tired, 2.5 hours. Four papers. But all the pump in the petrol kiosk cannot pump the high. It's a special compressor. Right? So you can have a look. I got some sample here. This is a draw call. Oh no. This is also a micro cable 48 cord. This is direct comparison. Right? This is a picture, the latest one, the micro cable. The use. Right? So, there is another one here, of course, the different type of cable. Right? This is the technology we use now. Compare with what we had in 1982. Right? And I'm proud, probably I can say that I was the first Malaysian to splice a fiber cable.
In Malaysia?
In Malaysia. First Malaysian, because when we had a fault, you know, in the Hill Station there's a lot of rats. They bite our cable. And I was in southern region in Malacca. Pola Pilah was under me. Pola Pilah Hill was bitten by rat. So want to repair the cable, we got to import a German from Bangkok. Yeah, because nobody knows how to do it. And when I tried to borrow a machine, the only machine was in KL. Cochrane Road, your old office.
Friend.
Yeah. Housemate. I mean, I'm happy with that, frankly. Because my philosophy is if I share what I've learned so far with somebody else, I'm forced to learn another time. So reinforce what you have. So it's not you. You see, when you share information, you share your knowledge, you do not lose, you actually gain. You actually gain. So it's a win-win. Yeah? So back to our old story. When we got a German here, the German wanted to bring the machine all the way. We look for a local machine. They know we have a local machine. They call AMT, built by Ericsson. The kind of machine was, you look at our pressure fusion splicer. You prepare a cable, you put it in, everything automatic. Right? The old machine, you prepare your cable, clean everything, you cut nicely, you check nicely, you put it in, you got to adjust top, left, right, up, down. Through a microscope to make sure that it properly aligned, then you set the gap properly, then press the button to arc. I don't know how many of you have seen a fusion splicer or done a fusion splicer work before. The pressure machine is you just prepare the fiber, put it in, you can close, you can leave your hand there. Now it's about 31,000 rupees. But the first machine I saw in Japan was equivalent to 1 million Malaysian ringgit back in 1982. First prototype fusion splicer, automatic fusion splicer, built by Sumitomo. Japanese way of doing things is they do their R&D together, Sumitomo, Fujitsu, Fujikura, everybody sit together, develop a prototype first. Based on that prototype, I will go back and add things to it, make it better. Then they sell under their own brand. That's why they develop. They put all the best brain together, develop a prototype, then improve on it individually. Right? Unfortunately, a lot of us do not have that kind of mentality. What I learned the hard way. You want to learn, what should I teach? What should I share with you? That is where a lot of us back. I always think of Tok Guru mentality. You know what is Tok Guru mentality? Saya sepuluh pak pukulan. Anak murid saya ajar 9 saja. No more. So apa? Nanti kalau dia pukul pada saya ada satu lagi pukulan dia tak tahu. So I'm always an upper hand. Okay? Even you pay your school fee, sorry. I still keep something to myself. So from Tok Guru to Papa Guru to Anak Guru to Cucu Guru, tinggal berapa? Tinggal separuh saja. Betul tak? That is a problem. That is a problem we are facing a lot of time. Third guru mentality. Yeah? So, okay, that's outside the point we share. And as I mentioned, I spent a lot of my time in fiber. I followed the development. I got developed interest in it. Until today, even this morning, I woke up, first thing I pull out computer, I search internet for things that I am interested in. See, my daily routine, I wake up 6 o'clock, I go and take a walk, 1 hour. Quick walk around my crossing area. In Malacca, I'm not here. Here, you bring all the people you die faster. In Malacca, we still have a lot of dreams. So I walk 1 hour, quick walk. While walking, my brain start thinking about this kind of thing, what I'm going to do today here. Right? The moment I go back, I start on computer, I search for additional information. And that is where you have something. Right? I share this experience with you because I find that that is very effective. While you are exercising, your blood is running to your brain, to all parts of your body. When you do this, that will help you think faster. Okay? So, that was the fiber. Today, the fiber we have is single mode. Compare single mode and multi-mode. Multi-mode fiber core size is 50 to 65 millimeter, micrometer, sorry. Micrometer, 1,000 of a meter. Is as thick as your head. And single mode is only between 8 to 9 micron. The core size, right, is about 20% of the multi-mode. That's why in the single mode, the reason why it's called single mode is because when you launch a laser signal inside, right, there's only one way the signal can travel. Whereas a multi-mode, because it's the size, the wave that reflected inside. So it follows different path. That's why it's called multi-mode. Multi-mode has got problem of dispersion. After about 10 kilometers, the signal can be sorted. That's why earlier, all these links were about maximum 10 kilometers. After that, it cannot work anymore. You cannot recognize the signal anymore. Right? If you are interested, actually, we can do whole detail into fiber optic theory, fiber transmission, optical transmission theory. That is where we learn about this thing. There's a lot of dispersion, there's a lot of delay and those things inside. Even though it's traveling at the speed of light. Yeah, it's very fast. But because of the fiber structure, it causes different problems. Single mode fiber is more, because it's very small, it's more difficult to handle. Right? It's not cheap, it's not more expensive than multiple fiber because you use less silicon glass. Right? Material wise it's less, but because it's bigger, easier to handle. Right? And actually, we are still using multi-mode now. The LAN fibers, that means inside the building, a lot of people are still using, although there is a trend to move towards single mode. Because single mode, distance-wise, a big advantage. Current single mode fiber can go up to 200 kilometers without building. That's what they use in submarine. Yeah? G654 cable. Fiber. G.654 fiber is used in submarine. And that fiber, 200 kilometers without back attenuation or even distortion. Right? But of course, in submarine cable, they build a lot of safety into it. They don't put a repeater at 200 kilometers. They put maximum 80 in it. Why? Because if you are in the middle of an ocean, we cannot afford electronic to fail. Right? You may be carrying terabits. Terabit is 1 million megabits. Right? If it fail, I think some of us may have experienced before. I think about maybe 10 years back, the Taiwan earthquake, right? The fiber, the cable, something cable broken, all of us lost internet. The Yahoo take half an hour to log in. That is a problem. So if electronic fail in the repeater, they build a buffer in such a way that if one repeater fail, right, that is a bypass part, the other two end repeater take over. That means you can bypass one repeater, it still works. So you put 80 and 80 is 160, it's still within the limit of 200 with a margin. That is a safety factor we put in into the system. There's a system design function. The one we go into very detail later on. Right? I have the opportunity to work with some really clever people, so learn something from there. I'm not an expert on that. I'm more a landed guy, not in the sea. I'm not a mermaid. Okay. Mermaid is a lady, sorry. I'm not a lady. Okay? So the fiber core we have blown in CyberJaya is one link connecting all the data center. 216 core, we see the cable, the bottom of the cable, that was the cable. It's the duct is so good, cable so good, even pushing my hand, I can push 200 meters. This cable is not designed for pulling. The bigger cable, 48 core cable, take one, that is designed for pulling. Hand pull. Right? But this cable you pull, it breaks. You can push only. That's why the machine is pushed by air pressure. Okay, just a quick introduction. Well, this one I think, forget it, we go carry on. Right, this is what we are covering today. Option to provide high speed internet, HSI. High speed broadband. Right, under Telecom Malaysia's term is HSBB. Right, high speed broadband service. Right. Then we use fiber. We call it FTTX. Fiber to whatever. Right? X means can be anything. Right? If H means to the home, B to the building. But the latest one, 2 years ago, Huawei introduced FTTB dock. Fiber to the dock. Right? There is the one we want to. We actually want to overcome some of the problems with this in-house wiring. You see, like, if we have a nice bungalow, right, with all the decoration you've done, then somebody coming with a fiber to the home. You want the speed, but you don't want people to mess up the building. What do you do? Huawei come out with fiber to the door. They bring the fiber to your front door, outside the house, right? Put a what you call ADSL or even VDSL unit there. So fiber terminal in VDSL, they connect to an existing copper pair into your socket point in the house. Right? From there you connect to an ADSL modem. That we what we use in our streaming. We use streaming here? Anybody use streaming here? The home streaming, right? That is the same thing. A small box, right? Always use that. So that use back your existing copper pack. And that way, it actually will come a lot of problems we will cover later on. Why streaming cannot go with high speed? Especially in a high-rise building like this. That is why fiber to the home is selling a hot cake all over the world. It's all over the world. Unfortunately, our fiber to home is a bit more expensive. Coming from telecom, I have to say that it's still quite expensive compared with others, even with China, right? And frankly, our internet access is also very expensive. Yeah, I relate one of my project last year, which actually didn't work out. Okay, then we look at how to encourage competition in FTTS, GPON. The system we use in Malaysia is called GPON. gigabit passive optical network. G stands for gigabit, P is passive, O is optical, N is network. Right? And then, how do we deploy it? What are the methods we want to install our fiber cable? We look at the trunk cable, we look at the metro cable. Metro cable has been running within the city. Okay? And then we have the access cable. Access means coming from telecom exchange or Maxis exchange to your home. Coming up to the cabinet. Then there's a distribution cable that is defined as cabinet out to DP, distribution points. And then drop DP to actually going to your home. We'll look at some of the picture later on. Okay? And again, that is what we try to cover. But of course, there are only over 60 slides inside here. If I cover every slide here, even one slide, 1 minute, 1 hour gone. So I'm not going to cover every slide. Most of these slides are meant for reference. We talk here, but we need something to refer to remind you. Later on, you can relate. Okay? Now, the current broadband technology. We don't use HSI, we use broadband technology. Right? What we have, ADSL, SDHL, ADS, asymmetrical digital service line. SDHL, symmetrical digital service line. VDSL is very high speed digital service line that can go up to 50 meg, even 100 meg, if within 300 meter. Single cable. That is where the problem comes in here, okay? And also ATM, ISDN. ISDN is dead now. ATM also dead, over again. Now it's IPH. Internet Protocol. Integrated Service Digital Network. Yeah, name-wise, but I'm not data service expert, sorry. I know ISDN is something, a lot of people use it to get a 2 megabit service. Using copper pair. One pair normal telephone wire, you can go up to about 1 kilometer from the exchange to the customer end, one pair of copper wire. Those were the technologies of late 80s, early 90s. ISDN, ATM, this kind of stuff. Right? Then we have hybrid fiber copper. A mixture of fiber and copper. Right? If you go to USJ, if you go to Damansara Utama, or even in Kajang area, we ask some coaxial cable running below the terminal cable. Anybody seen that? That is, we got HFC, hybrid fiber copper, or hybrid fiber coax. To be more specific, actually coax cable, right? That is used for, actually it was developed for CATV, Community Antenna TV. How this thing come about? Anybody know how CATV comes about? The reference always go back to New York. New York was the first city without a skyscraper. Tall buildings everywhere. Right? So traditionally, our terrestrial TV broadcast, like what we have here, we have KL Tower, we have Bukit Besi, right? We have Bukit Pelindung. Ah, that's Kuantan side, sorry. That's somewhere in Selangor. That's another one. Can't remember the name. Blue Gali in Genting Highland, these are TV transmitter. They have 20 kilowatt, 10 kilowatt power TV transmitter that do broadcasting. Then your house put a Yagi antenna and you see the TV signal, right? But if you have a lot of high-rise buildings surrounding you, what if you stay in the middle? Right? Or even in this building, you can be the top floor, but you're facing the wrong side. How do you get a TV signal? So the idea of community antenna TV comes in. They put a common antenna on top of a building, use coaxial cable to distribute. That's why it's called CATV. One community antenna shared by everybody. Right? So it developed, that was under DOCSIS, then DOCSIS 2 coming with fiber. DOCSIS 3 will improve the service. Now currently running is DOCSIS 3. Okay? then FTTX, fiber to whatever, right? FTTC to the curb. To the curb means things like your streaming service. DM will install the fiber for the exchange up to the cabinet. It's a huge cabinet. Put their equipment inside. They serve up to 480 telephone line plus a DSLAP, digital service line access module. DSLAP inside, they can serve 48 customer, and they need more, they put another DSLAP inside, serve another 48. The cabinet is about this height. I can walk in standing. Inside full equipment with battery, with rectifier, power supply, everything inside. No icon. One thing, no icon. We call it indirect cooling. Right? In telecom, they call it MPOC. Multi-purpose outdoor cabinet. MPUC. Okay? And FPTB, I go to the building. We will see some example later. Where are these used? Okay? And when the fiber go to the building, then distribute from the building to each customer using CAT5, UTP cable. UTP stands for unscreened twisted pair. There are 8 wires inside. They are twisted in a specific format. They can carry up to 1 gig, up to 100 meters. Not more than 100 meters. After 100 meters, it doesn't work anymore. That's the maximum you can go. Okay? And then, finally, the hottest stuff. Now, all over the world, fiber to the home. Fiber to go direct into your home. Okay? And that is what we are trying to arrive at after seeing all these things. Alright? I'm still old technology guy, so come and press the button. Alright, this is XDSL. You know just how I say ADSL, SDHSL, VDSL, right? It works on discrete multi-tone, DMT. These are discrete multi-tone carrier. VDSL works up to 10 meg. VDSL 2 may go up to 30 megahertz per second. Imagine your TV broadcast is only 100 over meg, right? 180 meg maximum. So if you send this radio signal into a copper wire pair, what happened? There's a lot of radiation happening, right? It's an RF signal in a copper wire. Your copper wire work as an antenna, it starts radiating energy out. RF signal out. And because copper wire are so close together, you see, up to 1,000 pair this size, right? 500 pair about half the size. They are very tightly twisted together, so there will be a lot of crosstalk, right? Pair 1 signal go into pair 2, pair 3, pair 4, pair 5, everywhere. And if you have all the pair are transmitting, there will be a lot of roja inside. As far as any signal transmission is concerned, what I send is a signal, right? If you receive my signal, it's a signal. If you receive other signal, it's noise, right? And it start to cause problem. So that is the problem with SDSL. That's why they come out with vectoring. The technology called vector. Anybody heard of vectoring in SDSL? Right? They forecast what is going to happen if you send a signal down a cable. They start to compensate before sending a signal down. That's called vectoring. So with vectoring, signal can improve, but there are also other problems with cable. Your copper wire comes down maybe mixed gauge. From exchange maybe 0.6, 3, 0.5, come to your house 0.4. Diameter, cable diameter, right? At RF frequency, all this become reactive problem, impedance problem. So it start to reflect signal all over the place, so cause problem. And in your house, normally what we do? A telephone come in, to the hall. I connect one pair of wire to my bedroom, parallel line. I connect one pair to the kitchen. They call it parallel tapping. All these are causing impedance problem to RF signal. So you have a lot of voltage inside the house. Okay? That's why XDSL doesn't work very well. Right? A building, imagine if you have a building, this how tall is this building? 22 story, right? How many units, if you look at this building, convert this building into residential unit, right? Each floor maybe you got four, at least 6 to 8 units. Right? 22 by 16 is 116, 170 over. 170 over, each one pair of cable, copper cable come up. Current housing rule is 2 pair, right? So it's about 500 pair coming up. Can you afford everybody 1 pair coming up? That's why the cable, riser cable is one cable, they start to branch off. That is where the crosstalk comes in, that is where the noise comes in, and XDSL doesn't work. Currently, I subscribe, my house got no fiber to the home. Maybe next year. I use training. I subscribe 1 meg and I don't get more than 100k. Because the copper cable coming to my house 100 pair. Everybody sharing the cable. Right? So there's a lot of noise inside, there's a lot of termination, a lot of connections everywhere. By the time I reach my house, I'm lucky I get 10k. Yes? I'm lucky I get 10k.
Don't worry, when you subscribe to Unify, you will have the same problem as
well. Yes, don't forget, when they sell Unify, now they sell it to you at 50 meg per home, 100 meg per home, 32 split, right? But read the fine print at the bottom, best effort. Right? Best effort, they don't promise you you get 100 meg. Even your speedometer, you can go to your internet, you click on speedometer and measure. Where you measure to?
The nearest.
To the nearest hub. It's not all the way to your server. You go to Yahoo, you want to connect yourself to Google, you want to connect to Yahoo, it doesn't go to Yahoo. You only to the nearest exchange of me. That's it. And that also never give you 100 meg. We will look at it, why? Because of this convention issue. Unfortunately, that is a rule of the game. That is a rule of the game because everybody wants to survive. Everybody wants to make money. Semua untung. Eh? So they play the Chinese drum very well. Tung! Tung! Betul lah? They joke about that. All the time untung saja. Okay, so this XDSL problem. Okay, this is some of the things you can refer. What are speed, different category. We even have ITU recommendations, right? But all these specs are based on under ideal condition. Meaning, minimum crosstalk, 1 pair, no tapping. Yeah, it's 1 pair of wire, perfect wire. If you talk about 0.5 mm, it's 0.5 mm all the way, right? Bear in mind, when you have your service other than the mixed gauge, there's also connections, right? In the MDF, we use what I call that IDC connector, insulation displacement connector. There's a special plunger knife. You put a wire, you don't remove the insulator. All the wire are insulated with a plastic cover, right? They don't remove it, they just push it in. Inside there, there's a knife edge. As you push in the wire, it will cut the insulator and nip the copper inside with a very sharp edge inside, right? Now, the problem here is, first thing, if you want to buy a clone block, you will want to buy whatever block. Because how many type of block we have? Clone, the different brand, ICO. People want to buy at lowest price. You call a tender, somebody call 1,000, 800 gets it. How to get 800? Don't forget, all this material, copper, is not pure copper. It's alloy. Copper with 17% of tin plus some rare metal to make it very tough. And memory metal. Kind of memory metal. I bend it, as long as I don't bend it beyond a certain degree, it go back to its ocean. When I release, it go back to the ocean. Always that way. You must test it a few hundred times to do that. That's called memory metal. The shape I make it, you can bend it, but there is a limit. You over bend it, it breaks. Before it breaks, you let go, it go back, it spring back on. So now, if you cheat on the metal, the alloy could be expensive. Right? You recycle material or something, you want to control. So it lost the property. Second thing is property. I don't carry my plunger knife, I use my test pen, my screwdriver, I push it in. You open up too big. It doesn't pull back well. So with poor contact cause a lot of problems. Impedance change, signal loss, attenuation increase, all this thing. So you can see 1.3 meg, 5 meg, 10 meg, 100 meg. But at the end of the day, what you see, what you get is the best effort. Okay? Now let's look at DOCSIS. Okay, any question on ADSL? Or streaming? I think we all have very bad streaming service experience. Coming from telecom, I know it. Right? Even our last ex-CEO, Dato Wahid, got a bad experience. Yeah? Just to share with you a story, he stayed in Kajang. So one day he complained. The time the highest was one man. He said he never get more than 10 men. I thank him. So they go and see the cable, because cable, old cable, away cable, a lot of breakage, water enter, low insulation, also cable. So they say, okay, run a new cable. Up to his house only. Yeah? Okay, we run a new cable up to his house. He was very happy because he was only user in a 50 pair cable. Okay? No interference, no crosstalk. Right? Then his neighbor come to his house. Wow! You got very good speed. Right? Next day, go back to the office. Hey, my neighbor want it. Connect for him. Your CEO said his neighbor wants it. What do you use? You use old cable or new cable? Right? New cable, new cable. So as he build up, after 2 months, he also give up. Because of the crosstalk. Right? That is a problem with that. That's why the vectoring only come in quite recently. Vectoring come in less than 10 years ago. Actually approved standards less than 10 years ago. I think about 2006, 2007. Yeah. So now we come to DOCSIS. DOCSIS is used by ABN, Asia Broadcast Network. You know where is ABN? You know where is Puchong Gate? Right, the office is there. Outside his office, you see there is a satellite farm. I think about 10 antenna there, more than 10 antenna. Right, they receive from there, and then they feed into the system and feed to everybody's home. Whoever is connected to the service. Okay, that's called DOCSIS. It's hybrid fiber coax. Okay, so the way why it's called hybrid, because this side, fiber or satellite, this is where the back end where they get the signal. The primary network is always fiber. ABN use fiber from where? It's from fiber rail. Heard about fiber rail? Anak syarikat pada telekom. Right? They use KTM punya railway line to install the cable. Okay? But of course, after KTM, they start to serve their customer, they run out lah. Tepi jalan, dia tumpang, tiang, tenaga, semua ada kan? So, that is this portion ABN used fiber rail. Here, they install their own fiber. From fiber rail, their top point of present, POP, they run a fiber cable, normally 24 to 48 count, out. Tumpang, tiang, tenaga. Right? up to a fiber node. We see what is a fiber node. It's an active equipment on top of a pole. From there, they convert the coax cable to every home. Okay, let's look at it. This is fiber node. Okay, fiber cable comes in. This is a fiber closure, joint closure. Connects into the fiber node, where there is an O to E conversion, optical to electrical. Right? And amplifier inside, from there, it goes up to the tap point. This is where you serve the home. Here is a cable, coaxial cable, I think almost as thick as my thumb. Very thick cable. Because they want to run for 100 meter with serving up to 50 homes along the way with sufficient power. So the cable has to be thick so that the loss is not so high. Right? So that is the main cable, and there's a drop coming out. Okay, the rest are power supply and all six. These are all active outside. Okay, drop six. What I have described just now was all that. Okay. Actually, there are some photographs I didn't put in because it was growing too big. So five become too big. There are some photographs showing how to drop to the home and those things. Maybe we will cover the opportunity again on that in more detail. But basically, that is how it works. Right? DOCSIS 2, DOCSIS 3 come with internet service. Not only TV broadcast, cable TV broadcast. It's also come with internet service, right? It can go up to 10 meg, but 10 meg is shared by 50 homes.
50
homes. Maximum 50 homes, right? So each one about, you divide up 10 meg by 50, everybody uses it, right? But there is always contention. We will see how the contention will go on. Okay, right, DOCSIS. Now, I just want to, that was the, actually DOCSIS is part of point to multipoint. You look at it, it's quite similar to this, right? There is a backbone running, and then along the way it starts to branch out. Right? We call it P2MP, point to multipoint, as against point to point. Point to point means from point A to point B, there's all one connection. Right? Point to point, point A can go to B, C, D, up to Z maybe. But point A only one coming out and start to grow like a tree. Right? So that is the concept of point to point and point to multipoint. And FTTX, that is what you meant FTTX. Fiber to the curb, fiber to the DB, fiber to the building, fiber to the home. Right? These are the nomenclature used by international standard. There is an organization called FTTH Council, Asia Pacific. Right? There's also FTTH America, FTTH Europe. FTTH Europe is very active with a lot of write-up articles. FTTH America, they are more interested in certification, American business. Certify you as a professional, they collect your money. I was certified by them, of course. Because the contract requirement will work with power. Some of the service provider, they want to make sure you have a proper qualification before you work on their project. They say they want a certified professional. So I have to go and get myself certified, pay I think $100 to sit the test. Then every 3 years I'm gonna pay another $60 to renew. Renew is not something you just send the money, you have to sit for a new test. So my expired last year, I just forget it. At my age, I don't want to get certified anymore. Right? So here, FTTS Council recognize all this as part of high-speed internet service, SSI, or high-speed broadband service. Fiber to the home cover all these things. Okay, now let's look at it in a bit more detail. FTTC, ETTH, okay, let's look at FTTB. That's how we talk about fiber to the building. Right? Fiber to the building means the fiber comes from the exchange up to a building. From there on, it could be anything. Could be anything. It could be you put a lease line inside a building. Okay? Then you have SDSL to every home using existing copper. Or, like what they do in Penang form or in Hong Kong, they pull a fiber to a building. From there, they use Cat 5 to every unit with an IP switch every floor. Yeah? Ethernet switch at every floor. So, this is how it looks like. Right? When the chains come out, main distribution, you go to the building, the green box, there's a box there. They do the O to E conversion, optical to electrical conversion for downstream. Upstream is electrical to optical conversion to go back. Okay? But here is one pair of fiber using 1310, one transmit, one receive. No WDM, wave division multiplexing. No radio multiplexing. So you go to the green box, then you go to a switch, Ethernet switch, active equipment. And from there, the switch may have eight port output, each port go to one home using Cat 5 connection. Okay? They just call it green box because in Penang form, this one taken from Penang form. Penang form, the box is green color. Right? It's just like in this line, right? We got a mini this line called pizza box. Yeah? In telecom, if you go to any area where not many customers, they don't want to pick a big structure inside. You put a small structure, they put a small DSLAM inside that has got 8 to 12 port on it. So it's as big as a box you buy a pizza in. You call it pizza box. It's a term that everybody use looking at the size, how you appear like, easy to recognize. Okay? Now, you see the connection from switch ground floor, you go to first floor, to second floor, all the way up. It's cascaded. Right? What is the problem with this kind of data? First thing is shared bandwidth. Right? Here you may come in 1 gig. Right? GE. Right? Gigabit Ethernet. But when you come to this green box, still 1 gig. Here, in the building of 10 story, this floor, get 10 meg. Oh no, sorry, 100 meg. Right? If each floor has got 10 units, each home get maximum 10 meg. Right? You are sharing because incoming facility is a limit, depending on how many you share. Okay? And don't forget, at a source here, there is also another switch. Right? Layer 3 switch. That switch connect back to the Metro E, maybe 10 gig. But that switch may be serving 20, 30 of this. Right? So there is a contention. There is a contention. 30. A 10 gig signal coming, we serve 40, so each of these branch out will get 110 of it. They say the 10 branches, right? So your 10 gig become 1 gig each. What if you have 20? 510 each. Right? So that is where the contention builds up. That is where, when you go to your speedometer in the internet, you go to the nearest node. And it stops there. Then beyond that, you cannot measure anymore. It doesn't know where it goes. Okay? So, That is one problem, shared memory. Second problem here, active equipment. We need power supply, right? In a multi-story building, you may install this in a riser room. The riser room is not so bad because they still, normally in riser room there is a power point, right? Socket point. That is maintained by the management committee. The trouble is now, if a cleaner come, want to start his vacuum cleaner, want to mop the floor, want to polish the floor, right? He know there's a power point inside, he will open the door, pull out your plug, he plug in his plug inside, he start mopping the floor half an hour. Everybody lost internet for half an hour. If you go to ground floor, the whole building lost. Yeah? That is a problem, right? Why this thing happens is because installer, they don't want to run the power supply back to the DP, power distribution point. They take the shortcut. That's one thing. Second thing, high-rise building, always lightning hit. Circuit breaker trip. Right? Because all the power supply come with a lightning protection. There's ELCB. Even a home got ELCB, but if a home ELCB trip, you know where to reset it. Right? But beside your home, maybe the main, some of other things in common use also trip, but nobody cares. Everybody complain about no internet only. This is exactly what happened in Sentul. YTL has got some building there. The, what is that? In Sentul, there's some high-end condominium there. Right? YTU has got a data center near the Central Railway Station. They use fiber to Orange Building and Ethernet inside the building. 2 years ago, I was in Huawei with a call-in to look at the problem, propose a solution. I look at it and say, okay, it is actually too troublesome for me to check all the earning. I can see a copper connection. But where it goes, nobody knows. Right? Somebody may have taken one bar of copper and sell away. Very common. Even telecom machines lost their copper. Tenaga lost their copper because of copper press. Right? Mak Yen just go there, take one lump, dia dapat satu shot dia. Right? Dua hari selesai. Very common. When I was in charge in southern region, I think almost every day there are things happening. Copper bar is stolen. Earthing copper. You may steal the copper bar, you sell it for 20 ringgit. For two shots. Right? But if there's a lightning hit, telecom will lose 2 minutes. Because equipment get burned out. Protection is no more there. Same thing with the high-rise building here. Yeah, this is a problem. That is why it's better to have passive all the way. One. Okay? Okay, this is what Penang for. Mr. Toh, you are from Penang, you have seen this. Right? This is fiber cable running along the drain, the monsoon drain, on the wall, attached to the wall. Right? Anybody can tell me what's the problem with this kind of cabling? I've seen even worse. In Damansara, what I call this, near the curve, what I call the hospital. No, Mount Gera, those are landed one. What of Dhamma? Near one of Dhamma, behind one of Dhamma, the area. No, Krabikana. Krabikana on the other side. Behind one of Dhamma, beside one of Dhamma. I remember the name. Somebody has thrown their fiber cable into the drain. They lay their cable, first one, put inside the drain, and go, the other side comes out, go to the house. You see why the problem is? You see this, the top picture? Right? As it rains, the water comes in, the rubbish has caught in the PVC duct. Right? It builds up. Then, after the whole cable, they wash it. Same thing as a cable. The cable in the drain, you know a drain cleaner, describe the drain? Describe the cable together. Okay? Now, the other problem. Look at this. 90 degrees down, 90 degrees, 90 degrees. Fiber cable bending radius minimum 30 times its diameter. If not, you put the cable under stress. Yeah. Any cable, if the cable is 10 millimeter, it is bending 30 times. Right. All 30 millimeter minimum is single fiber bending radius. That is 90 degrees within a short distance. Definitely out. This cable, I suspect, is a very high loss. But the thing is, because it's very short, this cable are all about maybe 2-3 kilometers only. So the loss budget is very good. Because there's no splitter, there's no other loss element. So as long as when they pull, it definitely works. Right? Because you use a laser, there's about 25-28 dB working margin. Right? Single mode fiber will give you 0.3 dB per kilometer. So it can go basically 100 kilometers if there is no joint in between, no connector in between. That is why I think they are facing problems in uniform now after about 10 years. Okay, fiber cable, mind you, life is about 30 years. 30 years minimum. In fact, it's supposed to be endless because it's silicon, nothing else. Silica glass. Silica glass is very stable, right? Unless there is mechanical damage, it will not itch. It will not itch. The first cable, single mode cable we installed in telecom was a long distance one, Focus, from Alastar to Johor Bahru. Follow the F1, federal one. Single mode, Fujikura cable, Fujitsu cable, sorry. Until today, it's still there working. 1980s. Still carrying good. Okay? Advantage of fiber, you can grip on your own, it's very light. Right, a copper is very big, very thick, very heavy, difficult to pull, light, cheap, unlimited resources because you can practically make fiber from sand. Right? It's from sand that you make the fiber. You don't have to mine copper. Okay? Then, one thing is, see, electromagnetic interference. Lightning tak kena, you can run your fiber next to a high tension fiber. Wire, even 22 kV, 200 kV, it doesn't matter. It's not going to influence the electromagnetic field generated by high voltage or high current. And that is why there's such thing as OPG cable, the one running on tenaga punya pylon, the earth wire on top, or even the conductor, inside the conductor itself, they are fine. Right? We will see some picture later on. Right? Better security, because you want to tap a fiber, people will know straight away. Copper, you can open and tap. Remember, I think in the 90s, we have a lot of Bangladesh that steal telephone calls. Right? They go and open the copper wire, they tap the cable and use your telephone dial-up back to Bangladesh. Mind you, a lot of these Bangladesh are graduates. Right? They are better than a lot of engineers. But they are working as laborers here, unfortunately. In fact, just 2-3 years ago, I was working in Brunei project. All the splicers there were Bangladesh. Fiber splicers there were Bangladesh, and that's 2 years ago. Remember, there was a big fire in Pasir Panjang Exchange, Singapore, in the MDF room. Somebody was doing some cable work inside the chamber, cable chamber, because they used a torch and burn some of those jackets and sockets. They had to switch off the fire alarm. If not, alarm will go. right? While they were working on it, they switched off the alarm. When they go for lunch, they make two mistakes. Forgot to put back on the alarm and leave their torch burning. The whole chamber was burned away. It was a big issue. I happened to be in Singapore at the time, working on one of the projects. And when I go there, I read the news, everybody was saying Singapore very efficient, set up 20 teams, splicing simultaneously. But I look at a picture of the mask. Yes, fine, it become a big issue. IDA fine not heavy. A few heads actually wrote. You lost your job. That was the case, right? Better security. Of course, fiber again also no resale value. In fact, disposing of a fiber cable become a hazard. It's a hazardous material. Everybody got problem disposing of odd pieces of fiber. You cannot sell. You cannot recycle. The best you can do is take out the sheet, take the plastic out. That's all. Right? You want to recycle the glass inside, it's too much of trouble and too little of quantity. Better go and take a few bottles on the other side. Right? So, there is no market for stolen cable. That's why better security. So what is PON and what is PON? PON simply stands for passive optical network. So no power supply. You get away from all the problems associated with power supply, interference, and all things. Right? So what happened is, if telecom use PON, it saves a lot of operating costs. Right? You see, you want to install a cabinet by the roadside, you need power supply. First, you must engage the contractor with another, put in a meter. Every month must pay the bill. Right? When come lightning, they are susceptible because telecom another cable come on overhead. You can pick up lightning surges 20 kilometers away and affects you. Yeah. It's true case because in telecom we have big problems with that. I happen to work on this project. I happen to work on this project in the 90s in America. Trying to improve search protection, and this was one of the major problems. Okay? So, these are conceptual illustration. Coming from exchange, you go underground. In the city like KL, everything is underground, not overhead. Okay? Only when you go outskirts, you can afford to go overhead. You see the next diagram. Okay? Go overhead. Right? From underground, it goes overhead and distribute. Okay, this is for your own reference, and this is inside the house. We can avoid cabling all in the house by using Wi-Fi. My house, I use Wi-Fi, no problem. Okay, now all the OIUs for fiber to the home come with Wi-Fi. Okay, Wi-Fi operation in the home. Okay, right? Paul, again. One PON is saved from fiber. One fiber upstream is using 1310, downstream using 1490 for triple play. Video, telephone, data, or internet. Yeah. That's one fiber. Then it starts to branch out to every home, that's why we call it point to one to point. Okay, this is demarcation. Earlier we talked about feeder, distribution, drop. Right? Okay, so this is responsibility. Siapa punya responsible untuk install and maintain, right? When we talk about splitter, all the vulnerable you need optical splitter. This is a splitter actually can become a silicon chip now. It's a small silicon chip. The whole splitter is nothing bigger than this. If you look at the splitter actually by itself, it's a packaging that make it big. Is the fiber connection, cable connection will make it big. The actual sphincter is very small. Okay? You have seen sphincter expansion, the losses are here. These data are important when you do a network design, because the 28 dB, you must know where it comes from. Okay? So always refer to this kind of data. You do? Okay, sphincter ratio. How does a 50 meg or 100 meg come to your house? How do you know you get 100 meg? Or when telecom say, I'm providing 100 meg to your house, how do they tell you it's 100 meg? Right? Basically, you look at this. Hey, sorry man, this sphincter ratio 1 by 2, yeah. Downstream, GPON is 2.5 gig. Okay? 2.5 gig. We always go for downstream because most of the time, most of us internet is downloading. Right, and uploading. Right. So downstream is always more important. So when divided by 2, it's half of 2.5 gig. So we get 1.25 gig. Divided by 4, you get 625 gig meg. Right? Divided by 8, you get 312 meg. But, see when the market. Right? Actually, 1 by 8, this, there's a mistake here, it should be 500. 500 meg. Contention again. Yeah? They always go to nearest higher. To make it look good. Basically, there is a reason for it. Commercially, if you want to provide guaranteed bandwidth, very expensive. Because all the way up to the source of data, you must provide. So they go on the statistical approach. Not everybody will put on internet at the same time. If you have 100 customers in one time, right, they expect maybe 50 to 60 to go to internet. Even when the 50, 60 go to internet, not every downloading at the same time. Right? Cannot. So there is always some room to play. That's why they have to go by the way. So now, what telecom is using now? 1 by 32. The market is 100 meg. It's all over the world. It's not only Malaysia. They say 100 meg service, split by 32. Yeah. So the split by 32, it can be a combination of 1 by 2, followed by 1 by 4, and 1 by 4. Or 1 by 2, 1 by 4, followed by 1 by 8 is a multiplication, end to end ratio. Okay? So imagine, huh? You can achieve 1 by 8 by putting 1 by 2 plus 1 by 4. The advantage of this is in future, if you want to grow your bandwidth. Let's say now, if you put a straight away 1 by 8, right? You make yourself 500 meg already there. But suddenly you need higher bandwidth. You gotta take away the splitter, put a new splitter inside. Right? But I said there's a lot of message wiring inside. What you do is you 1 by 2, 1 by 4. Right? If I want higher bandwidth, I just bypass 1 by 2. So at least the 4 are working. I just run another 4 for the other 4. Okay, so that is why single layer split and double layer split always there is some advantage. Okay, but those are in the network design planning session. Okay, this is what it means here. Centralized split, 1 by 32. This is same as this, 1 by 4, 1 by 8. Right? These two diagrams are the same effect as far as bandwidth is concerned. But physically it's different. Okay? This one, you got no choice, you got to change. Open this, change everything inside here. Whereas, for this, right? You just bypass this, you connect this end into another OLT, you have it working. Okay? You see, in this environment, you change this to 1 by 8, right? You also need another 3 OLT here. Right? This one is more flexible because you can play with smaller group. Okay? So this is how you plan your network to grow for next 10 years or 5 years, because this is something you want to install and forget for next 5 to 10 years. You don't want to come back every year and look at it again, because you got a lot of other work to do, a lot of other growth area to go to. Okay? So, okay. Just like I told you, the cabinet for this lamp, right? This is this lamp. I stand in front here, my height is always up to here only. Somewhere here only. Right? This is taken near my house. I'm using service from this box. Right? And this is a copper DP that we use for swimmings. This photograph show a fiber to the home, also near my house. It's a new installation, iPro cabinet 035. It's a new cabinet. The feeder cable come on the ground into here, go to the 1x4 splitter inside, it come out, distribution cable to this riser, right, to the top, and start go to everywhere. That's the distribution cable, right? From distribution cable here, this is the branching closure. A 48 core cable run on the main rod, then the side rod will take 12 core each to connect to DP. This is a fiber DP. Right? From this fiber DP, the drop wire, drop fiber will come out to each home. That is if it's area distribution. If it's underground distribution, like those bungalows, high-end building, high-end residential, enter the house also underground. You see no wire on top, right? This is another type of pedestal, and this underground DP inside the manhole. Again, the cable coming here, the fiber will come out to the port here and go to all this duct to go into the houses. Okay? This is how fiber get to your house. Right? This picture is a bit more complete. The riser, the FDC, fiber division cabinet, the manhole, where the feeder cable comes in. Feeder cable will come along the road, enter here, inside here. Okay? From that, it goes to area distribution. Right? This inside the cabinet. This portion is the splitter. This is the feeder cable termination. This side distribution cable is what? Okay? Here, feeder cable will come in and go up, because in the feeder ring, the OS is constructed in the ring. Every cabinet serve 400 over customers. And if a feeder cable fail, a few cabinets get affected. So they put everything in the ring. So that if one cable get cut, the other take over straight away. You can restore very fast. Yeah? Okay? So we don't want to go through, this is just how they do inside. Okay? Inside there, the jumper ring, the tri-stray cable arrangement, this is what you see inside your home. Okay? TM here, TM punya, Maxis punya. The Maxis has signed 2 million home pass with Telecom. They use all TM facility. They only install a residential gateway to route all the traffic to via server. Okay? So, triple wave ray solution. Okay? Earlier we talked about contention. Where are the contention coming from? Right? This is your home. Right? You have 3 services: data, telephone, TV, IPTV. You had a fight for your 50 meg or 100 meg line here to go to a DSLAN or OLT. Right? From there, it goes to the access. This is a Metro E user. They call it user access point or access gateway. Right? Again, there's a contention, because inside a metro network, there may be a few hundred of OLTs, right? But the metro ring may be 40 gig, 100 gig, serving a few hundred customers, a few hundred DP, 10 minutes, sorry, a few hundred OLTs. Each OLT may serve up to 2,000 customers. So there's a lot of contention inside here. They're fighting all the way up. It's a very tough game here to get the bandwidth you want. Okay? So when we talk about competition, when we encourage competition, what happened now is for telecom, you know why there is very little serial work going on now? Who is building this underground dark install cables? Only telecom is doing it. Time is doing very small. Maxis is not doing it altogether because they write on PMDR 2 million compass. Except for their base station, very base station, they will run some cables. Because any of these telecommunication projects, 70% of the cost go to OSP serial. The cost comes from there. So how to encourage? One way is open distribution network concept. Somebody build a network, anybody can use, pay for it. The rig in front of your office here, the one I told you built by Dr. Mohammed, is one of those. Anybody can use it, for when you pay for it. You can rent a fiber call, you can also rent a duct from him. There are some prices to it. Telecom would never lease a fiber to anybody. So it's Maxis. All the service providers do not lease fiber. They only lease bandwidth. Okay? Right, in service routing, you know, RGT is what Maxis is using in telecom facility. Okay? The cable, earlier I talked about multiple signal one. Okay? You can see 8 to 10 microns compared with 50 to 65 microns. And this is how laser signal travel inside each of these cables, these fibers, multiple and signal one. Okay? This cable here. Okay. For your home, because there is a lot of these tight corners. You see, you want to run a cable, imagine this wall. You want to run the cable to that side, you must negotiate this 90 degrees bend. Right? So all this bend for fiber is very high loss. Cost very high of signal loss. So they actually developed a special fiber called G.657 fiber, which is, they call it low loss fiber, low bend sensitive fiber. Bend sensitive fiber or the other way. Right? This is especially for indoor cabling. Okay? This slide illustrates. Right? A straight fiber for no loss, but when you go through a mandrel, a small mandrel using a pencil, you twist around a pencil, a normal fiber gives 11 dB loss to two turns. 657 is 0.1 dB loss. That is a special fiber. There are ways to do it. Right, but that is going a lot of details in the design. Okay? So your home fiber always use this kind of fiber inside your house. Okay, this is a cable design. They are basically two types, blue steel and slotted core, used in telecom Malaysia. Slotted core was Japanese invention. European always use blue steel. But in access network, because there's a lot of branching, blue steel is easier to use. So in access network, we use a lot of blue steel. Okay, so these are different cable use, different design for the purpose. How you lay the cable? Have you seen a machine like this sitting by roadside drilling away? This is a machine. See, all the drill you have can drill straight. This machine can steer its drill head. They're going to go to a certain depth, they go horizontal, that's how it comes out again. Okay? So this illustrates how it works. You drill from here, you can go underneath all the obstruction and come out with it. But this technology was used in oil drilling before. So the top one we use. Right? Open crash. No more in the KL. DBKL, I think 2 months ago, announced no open trench. Okay? Open trench means they do their resurfacing, charge you, if you want to do. Very expensive. Resurfacing could be something like a few hundred ringgit per meter run. Okay? Micro trench is the latest technology. The one in front of your office is micro trench. Okay? And then in your micro trench, you put in micro ducts and use air compressor to blow the cable through up to 2 kilometers. Right? This is the physical comparison between conventional trenching and micro trenching. So much of different. In fact, further up, it disappeared because it was trenched inside the white line. After it painted over, nobody sees anything. Okay? Area distribution, if you're not careful, you end up in Bangkok or India. I don't know where I've seen India one. They call it mihun goreng mihun. Okay? You cannot differentiate. No maintenance. Anything wrong, I run a new cable and leave the whole cable there because nobody there will cut any cable. Okay? Right? Power supply. Okay? Now, I told you just now, we can, because fiber is passive and is non-conductor, it can withstand all the electromagnetic interference. So, we install, this is called ADSS, all dielectric self-supporting cable in together with another cable, side by side. Or, here, this is OPGW. OPGW on top, the one is the earth wire to protect the pylon. Or OPPC, optical phase power conductor. So we have fiber inside all the aluminum conductor. Okay? Then we install submarine. Submarine is different technology altogether. Right? Cables are very heavily fortified. Normally, you look at this diagram. Submarine cable normally come in very small 4 counts, 8 counts, 6 counts. But the armoring outside can make a cable this thick. Okay? Because you got to withstand all the anchor from the boats and the ships, the fishing boats. And they are buried with a special trench. And they see 1 meter deep. Currently, some places they put even 2 meter. Because in the soil, in the marine mud is soft, anchor sink in, you still cut the cable. Right? So they actually marry 2 meters. Okay? This is just for your correct information. We have a lot of fiber under submarine cable landing in Lanzhou, Malaysia. Right? We have Kuala Muda near Penang. We have Klang, but the Phantom one. Melaka, Tanjung Balak. We also have in Pengerang, Johor Bahru. We have Mersing. We have Cherating. All these are landing stations, cable landing stations. This just shows some. I think some of your slide, earlier slide, didn't put this thing. Flag is one cable that lands in Kuala Lumpur. Right, but we have a restoration route through Semenanjung all the way to Singapore. Land cable. Right, it's flag fiber link around the globe. Flag. Okay, so that was the last slide. Right, sorry, I'm going to rush a bit because I think it's 4:30 now. Yeah. So, anything I miss out? I think once Sharifa has got my card, right? I don't carry too many cards, so got my email, anything, you can just email me. Need any further clarification, importance, I'm always ready to share. Yeah, with email and anything. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. I think I've been holding you on for more than 1 hour, I hope. Yeah, I don't worry to that.
Thank you, Sylvain.
Thank you.
Can't do much.
Oh.
Just wanna.
Okay, thank you.
Pay for your driving from Malaysia.
No problem. Thank you very much for your attention. I know it could be a dry subject to some of you, but it's something that we learn along the way. Yeah. I can't compress all my 40 years. I tried, but it's just too much of the pressure. The condensation ratio is too big.
Too much compression.
Yeah, too much compression. Okay. Thank you very much. Where do I find the time corner? And incidentally, there's a connector here. Fiber is always hanging up with the connector. Okay, thank you. Actually, for data services, we thought one company, end to end. But it's impossible to keep. It's impossible to keep. It's impossible. You see, like, here in less than 1 to 2, as far as a data market. Now, up in the metro, it will be even more than then your server, again, no server is designed for global. Especially if you go to the popular site, Google.
So the best thing is we invite them to post image.
That is why Google has got here, Google has got here now, right here in cyber. Cyber, there are, I think, 6 data centers, entity of 2. Right? And these are very high end data centers. In fact, last year I was trying to work on a project Super C. Watan, Singapore, missing. Then my project was missing from up to date. So I was, see, the was part of it. I'm going to come back. The other side it was Indonesia. The movie come to power. Right? The financial was the other party. That's why actually that was why I left the
One more question.
Yeah.
Okay, currently our biggest is 90%